So, like I was saying, so we help our, you know, clients with all their corporate training requirements, right? So, coming to the delivery modes, right? So, we do we have, you know, like very deep expertise when it comes to instructor-led training programs. We also, you know, do a lot of virtual instructor-led training programs. We have, you know, blended mode of learning programs. We have, you know, partnership with, you know, a couple of organizations on the e-learning front. Apart from that, right, we also, you know, keep doing a lot of webinars and open house programs. So, you know, open house programs is, you know, one of our strong areas, right? So coming to, you know, technological training programs, so we have, you know, very deep expertise in, you know, programming languages like Java, J2E. You have, you know, your AML, IoT, DevOps. You have, you know, cloud computing, cryptocurrency, data science. So we have, you know, deep expertise in these areas. So, you know, Stalwart Learning, it is a certified partner of Blockchain Council. That means, right, you know, we can provide 30 plus, you know, different blockchain programs like, you know, certified blockchain developer, certified Solidity developer, you know, certified Hyperledger developer. All these, you know, different kind of certification training programs, you know, we are able to provide to our clients. Again, right, these courses can be, you know, taken up as e-learning courses or, you know, a corporate instructor-led batches. We also, you know, do other tons of, you know, certified training programs like, you know, you have your, you know, Scrum Alliance, you have, you know, your ITIL, GCP, Microsoft, PMP, AWS. So all of these, you know, different certification training programs also we are able to provide. Right. In soft skills, right, we also like we have, you know, deep expertise in areas like business communication skills, conflict management, human resources, leadership skill, problem-solving skill, sales, executive coaching, and others. Again, both in instructor-led space as well as e-learning space. So for the e-learning, right, so we are, you know, partnered with Skillsoft, which is currently the world's largest e-learning organization. They have, you know, around 7,000 courses, 65,000 videos, 46,000 e-books, all of which are, you know, available on the platform. They also have, you know, integrated labs, you know, which the participants, you know, practice after, you know, they complete a course on the platform itself. Are also, you know, partnered with an organization called Open SSMA, right? So they have, you know, a most comprehensive, you know, catalog of e-learning, which includes, you know, 20,000 plus curated courses, e-learning courses. You know, their main area, you know, expertise lies in, you know, leadership's area, business skills, soft skills, HR, IT, and technology. So these are, you know, some of the areas, you know, where they have deep expertise in. For the soft skills, right, so we are also partnered with a Sweden-based company called Chart Learning. So their main area, you know, lies in behavioral training programs as well as, you know, blended mode of training program. So we also, you know, help our clients in developing their own, you know, e-learning content, right, from the scratch, that is, you know, from storyboard to, you know, voiceover development to integration. So we, you know, do all of this process as well. We also, you know, provide cloud labs to our clients for their training needs. So these are some of our clients whom we, you know, regularly keep on delivering training programs. So we have, you know, Travelex, DRDO, Siemens, SLK, ABB, Yardley, you have, you know, Sybase, Sony, Radisys, right? We have Wells Fargo, you know, Visor, Ananta Tech. You know, so these are, you know, some of the clients, you know, that we keep doing training programs in and out. So Gagandeep, so I hand over to you. So probably you can, you know, give an introduction about yourself and, you know, take it forward from there.
Surely. Thanks, Abhay. Let me just quickly share my screen. Okay, guys, welcome to the training session, this webinar. And about me, my name is Gagandeep Singh, and I'm a senior solution architect working as a consultant, freelancer, and delivering trainings as well. So I have close to 17 plus years of experience in IT industry, where I have worked with a couple of big MNCs in India and on abroad as well, on different organizations from with again further different clients I have worked. So 10 plus clients I have differently worked. So out of 17 years of experience, I have 16 years of experience in IT industry. And since last 3-4 years, now I'm delivering training and workshops. But since last 1 year, I'm completely into freelancing mode. So that is about my forte. And coming to cloud, I have been working on cloud since 2013. So I have worked on AWS, Microsoft Azure, and GCP, all three cloud. And we have, along with my team, I have built couple of private cloud also for some telecom organizations. So where they need a private hosted cloud in their own environment. So that is my forte. And now coming to cloud, or I'll not waste much time here. I'll directly jump onto the field where we are having to discuss on the technical front. So first I'll speak a bit about cloud, then about the Azure basic, and then we'll go further what Azure offers here. So when we talk about cloud, so very first thing is, what is cloud? So let's understand same. In traditional data center, we have three components, which is servers, storage, and network. These three classes are there, and there are hundreds of devices in these three classes. Like in server, we have server hardware, different models on top of it. We have operating system, then applications, databases, and all. Similarly, in network, we have different components like switches, routers, load balancers, firewalls. And storage, we have SAN, NAS, DAS. So all these components, when we put them together, combine them and put them inside a data center, inside a building, we call it a data center, and we manage it from our side. Now, our customers, they can be inside my traditional environment, right? Inside my office network only, or they can be on the internet. They access those services which are hosted on server and in backend connected via network and storage. So now when we access this kind of scenario, there are certain problems with traditional data center, like dedicated data center space required. If I need a data center in US, first I need to purchase space over there, then I can create, right? I need a license and all, lot of requirements are there. On spot demands, they are really hard to manage. Immediate demands of 100 server, let's say my production team is coming or my sales team is coming to me asking for 100 servers in 1 week. That won't be possible in traditional environment. So does the capacity issues? Utilization is usually less than 20% of your traditional data center. So it is not more than or not beyond 20%. Because if you think about your dev test server also, they are only being used for few minutes in a day. Why few minutes? We do build and test over there, and build and test run only for few minutes. Rest time development happens on your laptop only, right? And that too, there is no uses when my developer is not in office, when on Saturday, Sunday, no use at all. Provisioning time, that is in hours or days, not in minutes or seconds. Capital expense, we have to invest initially into the environment, and that is one time investment that we have to do in traditional data center. To avoid all these scenarios, we move towards cloud. Similarly, like you have your own car. So instead of using your own car, when you don't use your car much, what you are using, you go for Ola or Uber or similar cab service. Right. So now cab is being maintained or being purchased by someone else, being maintained by someone else. We are just using it and paying for what we use. Same way, these cloud, they are being maintained by the professionals now, not by us, in their data center. Ola, Uber, those cab services are available all across the world. Same here, when we talk about cloud service provider, we have some big giants here like Microsoft, Google, Amazon, The all three big giants are there in this industry, and they are really, really vast. They have hundreds of data centers across world. So I don't have to worry about where they have data center, because I can see hundreds of data center. I can host a server or a storage or a network or any utility that you want. Most of the utilities are available over there, and you can host it in their data center. So now management is their headache. They will purchase the server storage network. I'll just use it, and I'll only pay for what I use. This is like renting a server or taking a storage or network on rent. Now, instead of what benefit we are getting, instead of CapEx or instead of having a data center over there, self-created, now we become universal because you have hundreds of data center available across universe. On-spot demands, that is completely replaced with on-demand. Whenever you need a server, create it. Whenever you need to delete, delete it. No need to worry about capacity planning because that will be taken care by them. Utilization increased because if I run a server for 5 minutes, I have to pay for 5 minutes and then I can shut down and I'm not paying for it, right? So this server will be used by someone else now. So total utilization for me also increased, for cloud service provider also increased. Provisioning time, that is in minutes and seconds now. Some services minutes, some services seconds. Definitely not days. CapEx, that is replaced with OPEX, operational expense, right? So that is about cloud. Then characteristics of cloud, why we should move towards cloud, what are the benefits, what are the things that cloud supports and provide. Now, first thing is cloud should be on World Wide Web, on internet. That should be available on internet. So whenever you need it, you should be able to create it. So that is available on internet. Next thing is shared pool of services. All shared. You are sharing your infrastructure with someone else. Like you share your cabs with someone else, not directly sharing. Now you are using it. When you leave that cab, someone else will board that cab. So that way, when you leave your server, when you are not using your server, you give it back to cloud, and cloud service provider may give it to some other client. Shared hosting. Then on-demand self-service. Do you call anyone to book a cab? No, right? Do you raise a ticket, send a mail? No. Same way, why to do it for servers? You can create a server using an application, using a web portal, so you will, or using a command. So that is on-demand self-service. No need to reach out to someone. Just run a command, your server is created. Go to the portal, open an app, your server is created. Okay. Scaling. Scaling is to an extent that is really well possible. So you can scale out in, and you have scale up facilities that is elastic in nature. So you can just go through with same. So that characteristic is also provided by cloud. And in the last, metering. Every service that you use is being metered in the backend. So whatever you are using, you have to pay only for that. Okay. Now cloud is a service than a product, like cab. Ola, Uber, or other cabs, they are a service. Car is a product, but cabs is a service. Same way, when we purchase a server, that is a product, but when we take it on rent, that is a service. Okay, some deployment type, like you can use cabs. I can also use my personal car. So in personal car, you will have more safety, more benefit, more flexibility. I can change my personal car. I can change my music system. I can change my tires. I can change my rim. I can change a lot of things inside, do a lot of modification inside my car. I can run it as per me. But cab, there is limit modifications, limit things I can do, but it has its own benefit. You go to overseas, you cannot take your car over there. You have to hire a cab only, right? So these kind of limitations will be there. My car is only 5-seater. If we have 10 family members right now that have to travel, I have to go with a cab only. In car, you cannot sit 10 people inside a car, right? So what we do, usually we do a combination of both of same. You're on car and cab. You use a combination of both of them, right? Sometimes my car for privacy, or when we need more flexibility, need more easiness. And when you have to go with cab, basically for more flexibility when you are outside, when you have a requirement of more number of cabs and all, so in that case, you go with cab. And sometimes I don't have that much money that I can own a car. So what I'll do, I'll go with my family members, maybe my parent, my brother, we all can invest some money and then purchase a car, right? So we together we can create a car, and together as a family we are using that car. So that is my family car now. Okay, so same way when we go about cloud deployment time, your own car is replaced with your private car, private cloud. That is only and only for your company. So you have to invest initially also, later also you keep on paying. The benefit is you will have more security into this, right? Sometimes company legal compliance governance is there around it that you have to have. You cannot share, like banking sector, they are not willing to share their databases on a private cloud, on a public cloud, on a government or hosted over there on the internet hosted cloud. So in that case, they go with private cloud. When we talk about cabs, same way, here we have public cloud. AWS, Azure, GCP, they all are public cloud. And a combination is known as hybrid cloud. When I keep my database in data center and my web and application in the cloud, or maybe my test dev in the cloud, public cloud, and my production in my data center. So this kind of scenario is known as hybrid cloud. Then we have a community cloud where we are having a community, and that community is taking care, like few companies, they get together, get one cloud created for a common cause, common role, right? So that is the fourth deployment type here about the cloud. So that is majorly about cloud, how cloud is, what cloud is, and how we go with same. Now we'll be moving towards Microsoft Azure. Okay, so Microsoft Azure is similar cloud offering, a public cloud offering from Microsoft side. They also provide a public and private cloud. Private cloud is also there with the name of Microsoft Azure Stack. So they will install that cloud inside your data center. You have to purchase it and install it in your data center. That is Azure Stack. But by default, Microsoft Azure, that is a public cloud, and you can create an account over there any point of time. And you can create a server over there, server services, whatever service you want. And this was released in 2010. So second cloud in the market, second big cloud in the market. And the first one was AWS from Amazon. That was there in 2006. After that, Microsoft Azure came into picture. Available to purchase in 140 countries and in 24 currencies. Billing supported in 24 currencies. So 140 countries doesn't mean that they have data center in 140 countries. No, they don't have a data center in Pakistan, Afghanistan. No, they have a data center in India. But if Pakistan, Sri Lanka, Afghanistan, they want to use the data center of India or Australia or maybe US, they can use it. So it is available to purchase in those 140 countries. If we talk about regions, what is regions here? Regions is basically a logical area where they have a presence, where they have the data center. Like in India, they have three places where they have the presence. One Mumbai, next one is Pune, another one is Chennai, right? So these three data centers or three locations are there where they have the presence. So where they have presence means at least one data center. There can be more than one data center, but minimum one data center will be there. So that location is known as region. So 60 plus Azure regions are there in Microsoft Azure. That is more than any other cloud service provider by Q4 2020. Right? But in Azure, there is a catch that even one location can have a single data center also. When we talk about AWS, AWS says one location can have two data centers as well. And GCP says, no, in AWS says minimum two data centers will always be there. There can be more than that. When we talk about GCP, GCP says minimum three data center will be there in each location, and there can be more than that. So in Azure, there is minimum one data center. In AWS, there is minimum two data center. And GCP, there is minimum three data center in one location, right? Like AWS is having only data center in India, location in India, that is Mumbai. And in Mumbai, they have three data centers, three availability zones, you can say, right? So similar way, like 60 plus Azure regions and 90 plus compliance offerings are there. Like we have PCI DSS, ISO 27K, HIPAA, GDPR. So these all compliance. So approximately, if we talk about Azure, that is applicable there. That is available in all the compliance offerings, and a lot of services are compliant. You have to just check with them in case you need a compliance certificate from their side for any services. Okay. Now, service location, where we have service locations available. So when we talk about where Azure is available, what are the service locations? The very first thing is availability zone, means a data center. Right. So one data center, you can say, is known as one availability zone. So that is independent of that is having independent power, cooling, network separately, all separate. Then we talk about regions. Regions are basically one location where you can have more than one data center. Maybe one data center is approximately 10-15 kilometer away from other. Why so? What is the reason or benefit of same? For high availability. There may be chances one data center can have fire. There may be chances the data center cable that is coming inside data center for internet connectivity that got cut. So there are a lot of regions. There can be a flood in so single area in that particular 1 kilometer, 2 kilometer due to some issues. There can be riots. There can be power failure. A lot of things can be there. For high availability, they create multiple data center in one region. And then they have geographies. So not only HA, even the DR will be there within that geography. So India is a geography. In India, there are three regions, South India, West India, and Central India. So that is Pune, Mumbai, and Chennai. So India is a geography. Mumbai is, you can say, or South India is one. So like Chennai is there, South India. So that is one region. Within that region, there is only one data center, one availability zone. But there are a lot of data center in US, in Singapore, in Japan, where you have more than one availability zone or one more than one data center available over there. So this is the way here, like India is a geography, inside that Central India, South India, West India. When we talk about compliance perspective here, so why they have created geography? What is the benefit here? Benefit of geography is they make sure your data will not go outside of India at any point of time. Your data should remain within India only. Okay, so that is your service locations inside Azure. So there are multiple locations. You can have a look here. Multiple locations over there in this area, and in this area in India, there are three. And in Central India, you can see that availability zone concept, and that is about to come. Okay. Then there are East Asia and Southeast Asia where they already have an availability zone concept. So in Central India, that is about to come. UAE North, they are again coming with this availability zone concept. These blue dot means, if you see it here, available region. And blue dot with white dot inside it, right? So white mark inside it, that is availability zone available and announced availability zone. So this one, Central India, that is an announced one. Okay, so these many locations where they have the presence. So the soon, for example, if we are creating a free trial account today on Azure. So whenever you want to create, there is freely available. So you can create a free tier account any point of time and you will get 1 month free trial of $200. So when you create it, immediately on the same day, you can create a server in UK, you can create a server in US, or you want to create a server anywhere in Asia Pacific, you can create it. Right, that much big benefit is there for cloud. and regions that support availability zones. So these are some of the regions that support availability zones. So we have already discussed about it. Now, some of the services offered. When we talk about services being offered by Azure, there are a lot of services being offered in compute segment, in network segment, web and mobile segment, storage segment, database, security identity, monitoring and management, in almost each segment. Whatever you can think of your services, it is available. When we go and purchase a car, I have to look at a segment only. I can only purchase a 7-seater, 5-seater, or a 9-seater car. I cannot purchase all the 3 cars usually. If there is a requirement, I may be purchasing 3 or 4 cars for my family. Maybe possible. But if I already have a car, will I be buying a 2-wheeler along with same 3-wheeler? Will I be buying a bus, minibus along with this? No, right? So, but if you talk about those cab service providers, they have all the segments. You can choose what you want because it is their services that they provide. Same way here, in our data center, we may be using only 10 type of service, but cloud is having hundreds of service available in each segment. Whatever applicable to you, use it. Maybe I'm not using IoT. They are providing hundreds of services in IoT too. Multiple services in IoT. If I'm not using IoT, those services are not applicable for me. Same way, machine learning, artificial intelligence, blockchain, all these services, if you want to use, you can use. They provide those as a service. Right? So compute, network, web and mobile, storage, database, security identity. And when we talk about database, that is database as a service. Right? So they are providing me database itself. They are not providing. For example, if I go to a cab service provider, sometime they provide me a cab on rental per hour basis. In that case, driver, I have to arrange, petrol, I have to arrange. Right? Sometimes they provide me cab. I don't have to worry about anything. Driver, petrol, everything they provide. And sometimes we take the cabs or we take the car on yearly rental, like from a company. Normally, when you are in a company, you also go for that company lease policy. That is what? Taking car from company on lease for 1 year, 3 year, 5 year, like that. So what is that? That is also on rental service, right? You're taking it on rent or taking it from company for 1 year, 3 year and all, and everything you will manage from your side apart from car. So same way, if you just need a hardware from them, they can provide same. If you need a hardware plus software support also, they also provide same. Right? So multiple service types they provide. So again, few more service types you can have a look. Internet of Things, IoT, developer services, intelligence and analytics, HD Insight, cognitive services, machine learning, they provide hundreds of services for you. Okay. Now, there are pricing calculators. You can use these pricing calculators. So one is pricing calculator. If I want to see how much it will cost me if I go on cloud. Another one is how much I can save if I go on Azure and if I want to compare it with on-prem. So these type of calculators are there. Just click on these calculators. Links are there. So available over there. So pricing calculator, you can go any point of time. You can go over there, select your virtual machines, what you want to create, virtual machine, AKS service, or what service you want to use. Just select that service, go inside that service, select in what region you will be creating, what operating system will be there, right? For how many hours you need it, select it, about the license, about compute, how much there, and you will see the monthly cost here. So just before even you purchase, you can come here and you can see the costing. Right, that is cost calculator, pricing calculators here. Resource management, how you can manage the resources of cloud. Is there the only way that I have to go on portal? For example, if I show you here, portal.azure.com. That is a Azure portal where we go, and if you want to use a service, you can create a service here. Like you want to use a cab, Ola or Uber cab, you have to open the application and book a cab. Similar way, I want to create a server. I'll go to this portal.azure.com. I will log in with my ID. Like you on the right side, you can see I have logged in. So you will log into this ID, and then you will go with the services in the left, select the service that you want. There are hundreds of services available. For example, if I want to create a virtual machine, I'll select virtual machine and create a virtual machine. This is one way, like click on add virtual machine, and you can add your virtual machine by providing the details. You will provide your requirement. What is the name, what region you want, what image, operating system image will be there, what will be the size of same, and then you will create it. I'll come on this portion again once more. So you will provide your detail here and fill it. This is one way that you go on a website, web portal, and do the things. There are other ways also, like you can run a PowerShell command. You can run a command on Linux and a server will be created. You can run a command on Windows in PowerShell, a server will be created, storage will be created, network will be created, deleted, management, complete management of your infrastructure can be done with this way. Even you can write a .NET, Java, Node.js, PHP program also to create a server, delete a server, and manage all those things. That is SDK, Software Development Kit. Even not that, no need to install anything, no need to use any tool, just use APIs. Hit a API and your server will be created. It's just server. I'm just talking about one component here. There are hundreds of components. All can be created, deleted, managed. Everything can be done with APIs too. Once those services are created, then you have individual multiple component also. For example, a database got created. You can access the database via Visual Studio, manage it via SSMS, query editor. There are multiple ways along with once those instances are created. For example, a server is created. Now, how you will access that server, manage it? There are multiple ways. But to create a server, these are the ways. How you create? Multiple ways. And all our automation, you have to just select and fire a command, select the GUI, and your work is done. So let's talk about VMs first, virtual machine. So like you are creating a virtual machine in your traditional environment, in your data center, you want to create a server. When you have to create a server, a virtual machine, what you will be doing, you need some specific requirements. What operating system? Like as a developer, if I ask my IT team that I need a server, so what my IT team will ask, okay, what operating system you need, how much CPU you need, how much RAM you require, in what network you need, maybe shared zone, DMZ zone, or maybe for client networks, right? So these details he will ask usually. And then based on that, do you need a public IP or not? Do you need a DNS or not? Based on all these information, he will create a server and provide it to this developer. Same way, right now my developer don't have to go to IT or admin team, but my developer or anyone who want to create a server or a service or maybe any other service, storage, server, network, or whatever, they will go to portal, Azure portal, and then create a server over there. If they want to create a server, create a server. If they want to create a network, create a network over there and provide the requirement. That what kind of server you want, just provide your details and it will create. Microsoft offers a 99.95% of connectivity SLA for multiple instances deployed in an availability set. Availability set is what? It's a cluster. Within a data center, you can create cluster. Now, when you have two server, it provides 99.95% of SLA. When you are going across data center, 99.99% of SLA means your server, they give you a guarantee that server will not get down. Basically, your application will not get down more than 4 minutes in a month. What else we need? That's what we required, right? And that is here. Okay, and now Azure Virtual Machine, they are priced at a per hour base. When you see the pricing, they are showing you a per hour base. But when you use it for minutes, they will count you, or they will only charge you only for minutes. Right? GCP billing is in seconds. If you go to Google Cloud, billing is in seconds. Right? So if I'm using a server for 5 minutes only, I have to pay only for 5 minutes. That's it. It is supporting Windows plus Linux both. So you can create Windows operating system over there, or any of the Linux operating system like Red Hat, CentOS, Ubuntu, Fedora, all these Linux supports are there. Linux instances you can create. Cost of your licenses, somewhere you can manage, somewhere they provide. It's a combination of same. Okay, so that is about your Azure VM, and there is a relationship between it. Like if your VM is up and running, it will charge. If your VM is just shut down the operating system, but VM is there, then it is billable. If I deallocate, if I stop my virtual machine, then it is not charging you. My VM is not in use right now. Okay, currently, let's say my virtual machine is not in use. I shut down it, so I don't have to pay for it. I'll only pay for the hard disk of my operating system or data disk that is being there in the backend. For CPU and RAM, when it is not being used, you are not paying for that. Right? So that is your virtual machine. Let's create a virtual machine and then have a look here. So creating a virtual machine, I'll come back here. So first thing is I'll just log out and then log in again so that you can also have a look what kind of feel it gives. So portal.azure.com, that is a portal here where we go, where we log in with user ID and you provide a password here. Once you provide a password and user ID, you will log in into your Azure account, and in that account you can create all your resources. So I'll go in the left side. You have multiple services available: resource group, app, database, then you have Cosmos DB, virtual machine, load balancers, all these details are there. So I'll click on virtual machine. So when you click on virtual machine, there is an option for add. Just click on add and virtual machine. So we are creating a virtual machine now, and inside this, like in traditional environment, we have to provide some specific information about same. Here also we have to provide information. Azure Pass subscription. Will it be Azure Pass? Will it be pay as you go? Or will it be any other different subscription like TechLander subscription here? So this is basically where the charges will go. In what department, what account the charges will go. So based on your different department, different engineering team, different budgets, you will select your subscription here. Then you can create different resource group. For example, I'm creating resource group, that is my dev. So you can create multiple resource group, dev, test, prod, different resource groups are there. So it will group all your services that you are creating inside that resource group. So single point of view and management will be there with the help of RG. Now, virtual machine name. What is the name of VM? Whatever name you want. Where you want to create, all those regions are available. Right? So let's say I want to create in US. While sitting in India, I want to create a server in US. Okay, do you need a highly available environment that I need multiple server across availability zone or availability set? Availability zone means data center, different data center, or this is a cluster within a data center. Are you going to create a HA? No, right now I don't need a HA. What operating system you need? You can select out of these multiple operating system. If the operating system is not here, not listed here, what you can do, just see all images, click on that, and you will have thousands of images from marketplace where you can purchase the images on per hour, per minute, per year base licensed images. So you can see this license charges here, and that is what Selenium WebDriver on Windows. This is LampStep, that is free of cost. This is cloud management step for SAP. This is Windows Server, CIS benchmarking, right? Panjura is there, Cyberpanel is there, Nginx Plus is there. So multiple different options are there in the left, you can see. So select the option that you require. You can also create image for yourself within your company. That will show you here inside My Images. Right, I'll go back to create a virtual machine, and inside this I'll select one of the operating system that is here. For example, I'm selecting Windows Server 2012 R2. Right, this data center, this particular one image. Now, what will be the size, how much CPU RAM, and you can see the pricing also here. Right, so let's say I'm selecting this size. So these are predefault available size available option there. So you can select any of those size as per your requirement. Okay, now what is the username for this machine? Username, you will provide a username and you will also provide a password. That it will be setting this username and password for me. Okay, after that, public inbound port. So inbound port, what will be your inbound port here? RDP 3389. So it is a firewall. So by default, firewall is there. If you select none, no one can access this server from outside world. If you want to open it, yes, RDP is there. Then there are multiple other things, like you can define disk or storage here. That is your network, right? Storage, what different disk you want to add. If you want to select or set it inside a separate network, inside a different network, you can select that network configuration here. Management related stuff here. So different items are here. It's just that by default settings are there. You don't have to change. If you want to change, go here and change the settings. Custom data. I want to start some script, put up some scripts here that should be running when my server will be created. Okay, so whatever you want, you can provide, and then finally click on create. Done. So this will be hourly price, but you will not be charged per hour. Okay, it will be charged per minute based only, showing only in hour, but it will charge minute. So just click on create. So you can see on the right side, deployment in progress. Deployment is being done. It will take approximately 2 to 3 minutes to create your server. It again depends on organization, cloud to cloud. In Azure, that takes 2 to 3 minutes. In AWS, that is my practical experience. In AWS, it takes approximately 1 minute. And in GCP, it takes approximately 1 minute only. Okay, so this is being created. You can have a look. Deployment is in progress. So it is creating a network. It is creating a public IP for you. It is creating a firewall for that server, right? So that is about VM 180. That is a network interface. So you can see this description also here, that is security group. That is a firewall, public IP, virtual network, network interface, VM. VM is being created. So these deployment, multiple things will get deployed. And after that, it will tell you once the deployment is done. So this is the way how we can create a server so easily, right? Now, let it be created. Let's wait for a minute, because I believe within 1 minute, it should get over. Meanwhile, if you have any doubts, any queries, you can write in the chat. I can have a look. Okay, so deployment got completed. You can have a look here. Deployment is completed. So go to the resource. Let's go to resource. So this is your VM1, a virtual machine. And now you can see the status is running. So approximately 1 or 2 minutes only, right? So within a minute, your server was created and you are able to see it. Now, how you access it? Just select this IP address, go to MSTSC, like normally how you access a Windows server, you select a server, paste that IP in this particular MSTSC, or you can say remote desktop connection here. Just open it up. It is asking for password. Provide the password here and done. This is Windows. If you want to access Linux machine, similar way, you will access Linux machine via PuTTY, via SSH connection. Can be done so easily, the same way, right? Creating a server is that much easy, that cannot be there, that was not at all possible in our traditional environment. So my server is there and you can see we are logged in inside that server now. I'll just make it large, maximized, and you can have a look. So we are in Windows Server 2012 R2. Right, we created in East US, so see the timing as well. That timing reflects their time only. So the server got created. Now I'll close this connection, remote desktop connection. So this is my server, all details about your public IP, private IP, virtual network, about DNS, size of your server, disk is there. Today we created with one CPU, 3.5 GB RAM. You want to increase it tomorrow to 100 CPU, 300 GB RAM, can be done easily. Just shut down your server, change the size, done. You can see the size here in the left side. So you want to change it to any bigger size, go to any bigger size that is available. So multiple size series are available. You can select any of those series, right? And those series, select that, like 8 CPU, 64 GB RAM, and there are multiple size because of subscription also, based on subscription to subscription, this may get changed. You may have hundreds of servers available. These are different series available to you. Select any series that you want to go, select that, and then click on resize. It will shut down your server, change the size, start your server within 2 minutes. Done. You want to add a disk? No issues. Just go to your disk, click on, this is your swap OS disk. If you want to swap, if you want to create a new disk, click on create and attach a new disk. Just click on it. Provide your size, what size you need. Click on save, done. It will be created, attached to your server. That much easy it is. About security, there are a lot of features available here that you can modify. If you see it here on the left, lot many different features available. So this way we can create a VM. Similar way, if you want to create a load balancer, search for load balancer, it will take you there. So let's first discuss what is a load balancer. So I hope you all are aware about it, but still, let's have a look. So load balancer is what? It's a device where we configure a public IP. For example, www.amazon.com or sbibank.com. My users of same will hit that load balancer. Now load balancer will detect or will send the traffic to multiple servers in the backend, because one server cannot handle the complete traffic. Be it a super user or supercomputer also, it cannot run Facebook on a single server, right? If you open facebook.com, there are hundreds of servers in the backend. So how you open facebook.com and which server it is going, this load balancer will take it. And for example, if one server is down also in the backend, who will detect it? My load balancer can detect that server got down and it will stop sending traffic to that particular node. That's why we are using a load balancer, so that my end user should not have any impact in case one server is down. And second, it can distribute the traffic to hundreds of servers in the backend. Right? Then there can be multiple different load balancer, internet facing and internal load balancer. Internet facing load balancer, where my traffic is coming from internet. For example, facebook.com. So client is coming on that load balancer, IP is configured here for facebook.com, and from there it will go back to in the backend web tier, that web application server. From there it will go to internal load balancer, And from there, it will go to database or application tier. So that way we can have multiple layers here, so that in case one server is down also, we should not have impact. My performance is increasing. It's a scaled out approach, right? So same way, Azure also provide load balancer. So traffic is coming from there. So you can have a public load balancer here. Then you can distribute it to web tier. Then you can go again to an internal load balancer and distribute the traffic to backend virtual machine. And this sign, three dot sign, and this is your network. So all this is within one network. So in Azure, you can also create a network. Now, I'll go here. So you can see a load balancer as a service. Create load balancer, right? Inside that, he will provide the information. That your subscription, resource group, about name of load balancer, where you want to create, will it be public or internal load balancer, the SKU type, will it be basic or standard? Standard is more advanced. Okay, basic is a basic with basic feature. So there are a lot of differences between these two. So we don't have time right now to discuss, but there are a lot of features. Like it can support multiple across data center, it can load balance. So if your one data center is also down, it can send traffic to another data center. So public IP address, do you want to use a public IP over it? IP assignment, review and create, and done. Your load balancer will be created. Then you can configure it on what backend server it will be sending traffic, that you can configure later. This way we can create a load balancer so easily, right? Like we are booking a cab, similar way we can create a load balancer. Next thing is about scaling the infrastructure. What is scaling? There are two ways. One is scale up, another one is scale out. Scale up means within the same server, we are increasing RAM, hard disk, CPU. We make it large. That was a traditional old approach. Currently, this approach won't work. Because you can't have your Google running on one server. You cannot have Facebook, YouTube, Amazon, Flipkart, Grofers running on single server. Can't be. We need multiple server to support, because one server can go down also, and there can be always a performance limitation. So we go with scale out approach, means one server. Instead of when my traffic will increase, so instead of one, we are running two. After that, if traffic is again increasing, we are adding more number of servers. So that is scale out approach. Azure support both. AWS, GCP, they also support both. It is scaling. They are also supporting auto scaling. That service name in Azure is virtual machine scale set, auto scaling. Auto scaling is what? Based on your load. If my user base is increasing, automatically add a server. If my user base is decreasing, there is no traffic on Flipkart right now, then server will be, let's say, only two servers should run. If traffic is there, then five server. If traffic is increasing, keep adding one server. Automatically, without a human intervention. Addition of your server behind a load balancer, removal of a server, everything is automated. And that is very easy to be done. Very easy to done. Sorry. Now I'll take it here. VM SS, virtual machine skill set. Sorry, guys. Okay, create a VMSS, virtual machine skill set. So again, in what subscription resource group you want to create, the virtual machine skill set name, whatever name you want to give, in what region you want to create it, what would be the image here? So you can give your application image also by clicking on see all images and then select my images if you have created your application image. Guys, just give me 1 minute, please. Okay, guys, so I have two questions. I'll be taking that also. So is there any way to create an account without credit card? No, there is no way. You have to provide a card, but there are few ways. Like if you have purchased some subscription, like if you have purchased a subscription for Visual Studio, then they are providing $100 per month for BitSaving. If you have DevOps, or there are multiple different subscriptions available to them. If you show them that you are working on a project, development project on Azure, they may give you $150 per month, but for that you have to apply. They are also giving Azure passes to their partners. Like if you see on my account, I have a Azure pass subscription. That is a partner account, right? So multiple subscriptions are there that you can utilize. Okay, but as a personal individual user, normally you have to give credit card, but that is very safe. Don't worry, apart from 2 rupees, they will not charge you anything. If you are overusing it also, they will not charge your credit card. You have to create a new subscription. Without creating a new subscription, you will not be charged. And to your answer, Swapnil, yes, public IP will remain static. If you want to manually change it later on, you can change it. Okay, that is completely in your hand. You want to remove a IP from one server, you want to attach it to another server, or attach it to a load balancer, can be done. Okay, yes, the standard load balancer Vishesh, that is across availability zone. Okay, across availability zone means across data center. That is there. Basic is not there, but standard load balancer is across availability zone only. Okay, guys, so next is, we'll come back here to virtual machine skill set, VMSS. And inside VMSS, if you have a look here, so image, you will select your image. You will select what type of instance it is. And guys, these all service providers, they are also giving you very, very different options available here. You can even bid for a server. You can bid that if a server is freely available, like the normal charges for a server is, let's say, $100. So you can ask them, if you are giving it to me in $30, then okay. Otherwise, I'm not okay with saying, don't give me, I don't need it. So that kind of bid also you can create. Okay, that is port instance here inside it. So price or capacity, I can select what is my price. I can give my price here. You can see it here. Okay, and that is with normal server also. It's not just about virtual machine scale set or auto scaling. This option is available while you create a normal server too. Okay, but there are limitations with this kind of server. Okay, now what will be the server size? You will select a server size, you will select a authentication type, and that can be SSH key or password. So after selecting this, you will go next, disk. What will be the disk options available? Hard disks. How many hard disks you want to add, attach, and all. You can attach new different hard disk. That option is there. And different types also available. Standard, solid state drive, hard disk drive, multiple different option. Fast, slow, all type of disk. And charges are also separate. Huh? Next is about network. You can select under what network it will go. It can create a new network. You can select multiple networks. So one can be DMZ, one can be shared, one can be for client one, client two, different networks can be there. Select the network where it will create a server. Next, scaling. So when we see scaling, it is basically how many servers you want to create. Manual scaling means I'll manually increase or decrease the server. Custom scaling means it will create minimum number of instances 1, maximum 10. Currently we need 2, or you can say currently I need 5 server to be created. And based on my CPU threshold, it will increase the server or decrease the server. If my CPU utilization is more than 75% for last 10 minutes, it will add one more server. If my CPU utilization is less than 25%, right, then decrease one server. Duration is same here inside this. It's just about CPU right now, but later on you can have it, like once you create it, review plus create, later on you can change it, you can add more conditions also. conditions like on 25, 26, 27, I know on my website there is a sale. So when there is a sale period, then I need 10 server or 20 server on that day. So you can create it in advance also, that on that server I would be needing 20 server. It will automatically create 20 server, add it behind a load balancer, and your application will automatically have it. You don't have to do anything. On top of disk network, if my traffic is increasing, add more server. If my traffic is decreasing, remove server. I want to save the cost. All that can be automated with that way. After that, create, go to management, go to health, and then simply review create. It will take hardly 2 minutes and your servers will be created. If there are 10 servers, 10 server will be created within 2 minutes, 2-3 minutes. Right, that is your virtual machine skill set auto scaling, and you can keep on configuring it. Configuration is just once. Later on, you are burden free. That's how Amazon, Flipkart, their sale is going on. They don't have hundreds of server running all the time. No. If traffic is not there, only 5 server. If traffic is there, there may be 1000 server also. And there is no human intervention, all automated. And that is what you can do it with this too. Right? That is your auto scaling here. Virtual machine skill set. Next thing is Azure virtual network. So you can create a VM. Like we can create a VM, similar way you can create a virtual network also. You can create a network, you can create a subnet. Subnet also can be created very easily. So what you need to do here is, on the top, just search for VNet here. Virtual network. That is a service where you can create a virtual network. At any point of time, you can just simply say create a VNet, virtual network. Because physical network is already there in the backend. So you don't have to worry about the physical connectivity. Physical connectivity they already have. From our side, we need a virtual network on top of that physical network. Like in our traditional data center, we are creating VLANs. Right? So similar here, what we need. So you will go with any resource group, create a VNet name here, VNet 1, where you want to create in East US. What will be the IP address range here? This is my IP address range. You want to change it, you can change it. About your subnet, what will be your subnet? Under security, do you need a Bastion host, DDoS protection, firewall? You can select any one of them as per you. And it's not free, guys, chargeable. If you go with Bastion host, separate charges, DDoS, separate charges, firewall, they provide you as an option. You can use it. Finally, review plus create. Just review plus create and then click on create. So your server, this network will be created within a minute. It'll hardly take a minute. While if we have to create in traditional data center, creating a network usually take days. Because you have to plan, you have to go, you have to configure it on the switches, routers, routing, everything you need to configure. Here it is all simple. Right, your deployment completed, go to resource, your network is there. Now within this network, you want to create servers, create a server, quite easy. You want to add firewalls, you want to add subnet, other connected device, network, DNS service, all this is possible. But this network is in Azure, right? This is in Azure data center. Can I have options like this that my one server that is in my data center, can it be connected to internally this data center, this VNet? If I create a server here, maybe I want to have a web server inside this VNet, web server. And database I want to keep in my data center. So database will not have a public IP, right? How to connect these two servers internally via private IP address? Will it be possible? Yes, that is perfectly possible, can be done. There are multiple ways to it. Site to site connectivity is there. So like you are connecting your two data center. Your one data center is in India, second data center is in, let's say, Australia. How you connect? You connect internally, right? Via VPN connection over the internet, via IPsec tunnel. Like we connect, when we create a VPN IPsec tunnel, when we are using work from home, for our office work. Same way, data center to data center can also create VPN tunnel. Similar way, you want to go with point to site connectivity. You want to use your software in your laptop, like you are connecting with your laptop, you are connecting to your office network. Do you want to connect to Azure network also, private IP? Can be done. Point to site connectivity. I need a dedicated connection with Azure. Can you provide me a dedicated connection? Can Azure provide me? Yes, there are partner network. They provide a dedicated network also between your data center and their data center. Again, you have to bear the charges, but option is available, right? Within two network, there can be connectivity also. By default, there is no connectivity if I create two network inside this Microsoft Azure. So VNet 1 created, VNet 2 created. So why we create two VLAN? For separation, right? But if I want that two VLAN should be connected on any port, protocol, or maybe any routing I want to open. So same here. Here also it can be open. And all automated. No need to reach out to Azure for anything. All can be done with automation here. Right? Similar way, when we talk about storage services, there are multiple storage service options available. And you can create Microsoft Azure storage account, where you have file storage, blob storage, table storage, queue storage, different storage services available, right? So for that, you will go with storage account, storage accounts, and you will create a storage account over there. So create a storage account simply, and you can have up to 500 terabyte of data inside that. 500 terabyte of data in one account, and you can create hundreds of account. So basically you can say that unlimited data you can store over there. Give it a name where you want to copy the data, and this name should be unique on internet. What kind of performance you want, what kind of, where your data replication will go, within data center, across multiple data center, across region, right? This is across region. And now this is read access geographical region. So there are multiple ways. You want to go larger, it will go slower. Within one data center, if you want to keep three copy, definitely it is faster. And charges are also low. But if you want to go RAGRS, means I want to keep it in two regions. One copy in India, second copy in Singapore, for example. If you want to copy in that way, that two regions you want to copy and simultaneously parallelly six copies will be maintained, it will be highly charged, right? But they give you option. If you want to create it, simply create it. Click on review, create, done. Create it. So within a minute, this will also get created. Now, once it is created, then you can create, you can upload file, like you can upload file in Google Drive, you can upload it here. There is a storage account like Q, file storage, file share is there. So all those different options will be available inside this. So creation is quite easy. Management is quite easy. Now think about all these aspects in your traditional environment. Can we create a storage account with just two clicks? No, right? Network, no way. Now, we have been connected just last since 1 hour, right? Within 1 hour, we have created multiple servers. We have created a server. We have created a network. We have created a storage account. And I could have created 100 server by just typing 100 count over there. Done. So 100 server within 5 minutes can be created. Go to resource. Now, when you go inside this resource, you can see containers, file share, table, that is a NoSQL database, queue, that is like we are using queue service, Redis and queue and all. So those services are also available. You can start using it now. That's it. It is available. If I go inside container, I want to upload anything, I can click on create container, right? Give it a container name, create it. So this is like a folder or a drive, like Google Drive, and you can upload your photos, pictures. This is only private to you. If you want to make it public, you can make it public. Otherwise, it is private. All that is optional. Quite easy. Whatever you use, you only pay for that. Right now, I have created it. I'm not uploading anything. I'm not being charged. As soon as I start uploading, I'll start getting charged. Right? Based on per GB also, based on access also. So there are multiple ways where you can copy your data, how it will charge you, multiple ways available. Right? Similar way when we talk about database, so there is SQL DB database available inside it. So multiple type of databases, not just one. If you click here, you click SQL databases, you can see this database. If you click here again, and you can see all services, inside all services, go to database, and you can see inside database, multiple database, Cosmos DB, that is a NoSQL. All four type of your NoSQL, columnar database, graph database, then you have your key pair value database. All these database types are available inside this single DB. MySQL Server, SQL Server, Redis, Elastic Pool, SQL Server Registry, Elastic Job Agent, different server types are available. If something is not available, you can create a VM. On that VM, you can install the database. Now, what is difference between this and if we go with virtual machine? Here, you are not creating a VM, you are creating a database. I'll click on this database and I'll just click on add here, create a SQL database. Select a resource group. Then database name, what database name is there? Select a server. If you need to create a server also, listener basically for this database. So what will be the listener that will be available over the internet? What will be the admin login name? I think I need to give Gavin here only. Okay, so once I click OK, it will create a database server, listener server over there, right? Now, when I come here, SQL Elastic Pool, compute storage, network, additional setting, all. So when I click on review and create, within 5 minutes, it will create a database for me. And in highly available environment, not a single server, in HA server, across availability zone. Will I get a operating system access? No. Will I get a database access? Yes. You can access this database because this is a SQL database. So you can use SQL Server, SQL Workbench. Or you use your application, you configure your application to access this SQL Server. Access this database. That's so simple here. And you are paying for a database, underlying what operating system is there, vulnerability, patching, fixing, backup of database, everything they will take care. We don't have to. Database vulnerabilities, they will take care. Maintenance of database, they will take care. What we will take care? How we create tables inside it. Indexes. Who will have access to this database? That portion we will take care. So this is platform as a service, PaaS. Okay. So this is how you can create database. Similarly, you can create Kubernetes service too. Right? Kubernetes service, that is AKS service. Azure Kubernetes service. If you have heard about Kubernetes, so in Azure, you can have Kubernetes as a service. So you can just search here, Kubernetes, and it will show you here, Azure Kubernetes service. So Kubernetes as a service, you can create a Kubernetes cluster, add a Kubernetes cluster with just ease. Like you can create a SQL database, that is a PaaS service, this is also a PaaS service. Just provide a Kubernetes cluster name, what Kubernetes version you want, select that version, the node size, what will be the node size here, how many nodes will be there in your cluster, authentication, network, node pool, you will select all. Click on review create, it will create a cluster and you will start using that Kubernetes cluster with kubectl commands. That easy it is to work with Kubernetes cluster. Similar way, I want to create a container registry. You must have, if you have worked with Docker, you must have heard about Docker Hub, right? So container registry, So what is container registry? Similar to Docker Hub, you can create your own private registry. Docker Hub is public one, available to all. I want to create only for my organization, so you can create it. Simply give a registry name, location, and finally click on review create. Within a minute, your registry will be up and running. And you can start using it with your Docker instance by using Docker login, Docker logout, all those features. So all these things are quite easy and available, guys. Okay, so that is quite easy. You can go ahead any point of time and create any of these services. If you click here on left side, click on all services here, and these are the service types: blockchain, AI, ML, analytics, containers, mobile, web. Different options are available. You can just click on each of these items, start looking at it, what are different options available, and start playing around with this. So when you go on Azure.